What's going on, everybody? Josh here from Hunts Photo and Video, back again with yet another first look Q&A session. Today, we're going to be taking a look at the brand new Nikon Z6II and Z7II. We are joined once again by Mark Cruz, senior manager for Nikon. Mark, thank you for joining us.
My pleasure, Josh.
So I guess let's just jump right into this, wasting no time. Let's just quickly talk about what makes these cameras really different from their predecessors, the Z6I and the Z7I.
Yeah, so the original Z6, Z7 came out only 2 years ago. And in that time, we've taken a lot of user feedback and we've addressed a lot of the issues that people had or some new functionality that they wanted through firmware updates. And we were able to do that with iDetect, you know, compatibility with CF Express cards. But now we really got to get into the hardware updates. That's why it's so important that we have the next generation of these cameras, Z6II, Z7II. What's great about it is that the Z7 and Z6 remain in the lineup. Now people can see whether or not they need these upgrades that they've been asking for. A lot of people have been asking for things like dual card slots, which we now have. That's important for event photographers, wedding photographers that need that redundancy. So we have primary card is CF Express, secondary card is SD. The more readily available, and some people have those legacy cards available. As you see, what I'm holding in my hand right now, I also have the vertical battery grip. In the original versions, we had a battery pack that was a hot swappable battery pack, but it didn't have a shutter release button. It didn't have a shutter speed aperture dial. This now has the proper contacts in the body to communicate all of that to this new grip. This is the MBN 11, and this now is compatible with both the Z6II and the Z7II, so that's another hardware upgrade. We also have dual processors in both of these cameras now. Dual processors that allow us to get more than triple the buffer capacity in both of these cameras in combination with the CF Express card, which also our higher-end customers have been asking for a larger buffer. So out of those things, we've addressed both the dual card slots, the vertical battery grip, and larger buffer. Now, a couple of the other key items that we've updated for video, 4K 60 that we have in this now, as well as improvements in IAF.
Fantastic, fantastic. So I know you mentioned the battery, the new grip. So you're saying the previous version, the MBD10 battery pack, will not function with that, with these new cameras?
Okay, I'm glad we're asking these questions, but it is actually compatible with this. So the Z7II and Z6II are cut almost exactly the same way as the predecessor. What we have right now is compatibility with the MBN10 battery pack. So this is great because you can continue to use those accessories. Even if you have, you know, L brackets and underwater housings for the first generation of cameras, you can still use that on the Z6II and the Z7II. Okay, so the only thing is that if you have now the MBN11 battery grip, you can't use that on the first generation because it doesn't have those contacts. So Z6II, Z7II will be compatible with the MBN11 battery grip.
Fantastic, fantastic. And I know that the Z5, which we talked about last time, has the added bonus of being able to do AC power without a dummy battery. Do these two cameras also have that ability, or are we out of luck there?
Yes, actually, I'm using it right now, the USB power delivery. So we started that with the Z5, and now we have it in the Z6II, Z7II. USB power delivery is great because, as you said, you don't need that quote-unquote dummy battery. It's cheaper and it's readily available. You can power your camera through your laptop. And I do that a lot when I do my Twitch streams and things like what we're doing right now. We can power the camera indefinitely. And you can use that. You can do that with any of the ENEL-15 batteries. We have actually four iterations of this battery, ENEL-15, A, B, and C. The camera now ships with the ENEL-15C battery. It's actually an advancement in battery performance versus the first generation. We're getting probably around 150 more shots on a charge based on SEPA standards with the second generation of cameras. And we can record right now up to, I think, an hour and 45 minutes of video with these batteries. So what I have in my hand too is the grip. Now, the grip also allows you to put two batteries in here. So you can almost get double the battery life. It's 1.9 times the battery life. But the cool thing about this grip is that the first battery closest to the door is hot swappable. And so what that means is, if you are doing a video production or a time lapse and you don't want to interrupt the camera, you can take out one battery. It's still going to pull power from the first one deeper into the grip, put in a fresh battery, and you can literally keep going and going and going. So that's the MB-N11 battery grip.
That's awesome. That's fantastic. Actually, I was about to ask about the hot swappable batteries, but you completely read my mind. So what about the low light performance? How has that been improved from the first generation of these cameras over to these new ones?
Yeah, so in the generation 2, Z6II, Z7II, we now can focus at about half the amount of light and low light scenarios. So for the specification, it's negative 4.5 EV on the Z6II and negative 3 EV on the Z7II. And this has been accomplished through a couple of things, optically through the lenses and as well through the body, through the refresh rates. So we can essentially perform at lower light scenarios versus the first generation, which is a welcome benefit for the higher end photographers, and or even just people shooting in low lit banquet halls and things of that nature. They're gonna really appreciate the differences focusing in those low light scenarios.
Beautiful. What about the autofocus? Has it been improved for face detection at all?
Yes, in a couple of ways. First of all, in this new generation 2 of cameras, we can eye detect in video now. This is something that we didn't have as a feature in the first generation. So video now has eye detect. And as well, for the eye detect, we have now implemented it in one of the focusing modes called wide area AF. Now, I'll just rewind back to the first generation. Eye detect was available in something called auto area AF. And essentially, it would look around the entire frame and pick out eyes in the entire frame. Now, if you had multiple faces in that frame, it could grab from several different faces. Now you can concentrate where the camera focuses or tries to search for eyes into a section that is bounded by a red box. So you can move that red box around the frame and be very specific on where it finds the eyes and concentrate on your composition more so than trying to kind of fight where the camera is trying to find the eyes from. While we're here on the topic of focus, is subject tracking has been improved in terms of the way it's implemented in these cameras now. For people that are using Nikon DSLRs, it mimics the 3D tracking on DSLRs. So I just want to mention that too. You can program your function button to quickly acquire or access the subject tracking. And when you depress the shutter release, it will engage your subject. When you release it, it will kind of revert and anchor back to the center. And that's basically very consistent with what people were used to with 3D tracking on DSLRs.
The blackout time between exposures, has that been improved from the first generation over to this generation as well?
Yes, we just keep getting better and better with these things. And especially for people coming from DSLRs where the blackout time has really been perfected and minimized. I'm not going to go into the mechanics of mirrorless cameras and the way the mechanical shutter works, but we were able to improve the blackout time when you're shooting in continuous high speed. Not the continuous high speed extended, but continuous high speed. There's a mode there that goes at about 5.5 frames per second. We've minimized that blackout time with a sequencing adjustment. So basically, you'll be able to see the live view for a longer period of time in between shots as well. It helps with the autofocus track your subjects as well, because it's viewing through the live view longer. So marginal improvement on the autofocus tracking, but also you'll see the subject longer in between in between shots in continuous high speed.
On the subject of high speed, what are the frame per second improvements from the last generation to this generation, if there are any?
Yeah, thanks to the dual X-Speed processors, we've been able to bump up both the Z6II to 14 frames per second, as well as the Z7II to now 10 frames per second. And that's no small task. We're talking about Z7II that's 45.7 megapixels. This is medium format territory here. And we're able to go to 77 shots at 10 frames per second. And we do this because of that dual X-Speed processors and the fast CF Express cards. With the Z6II, we can achieve up to 14 frames per second. That's up from 12 frames per second on the original Z6. And again, we're more than tripling the buffer. I think we're up to 124 shots before we exhaust the buffer. Yeah, and so this is something that we've only previously accomplished with the D6 at 14 frames per second. So this is a new benchmark. We have the first time we've hit it with a mirrorless camera.
You were mentioning the cards in there. Am I able to still use my older XQD cards with, you know, in tandem with the SD card, or is that a non-starter?
Great question. The answer to that is yes. So if you have a D850, D5, D500, D4, D4S, et cetera, et cetera, You can still use your XQD cards. It's fully compatible with the CF Express card slot right out of the gates. So the one thing I will tell you is that the CF Express Type B that we're using in here, which is the same size and shape as a XQD card, the value that you're getting for XQD cards now is so high, dollar for dollar, you know, gigabyte for gigabyte, with the speeds that you're getting, which is four times faster than the fastest XQD card right now, which XQD is already faster than the fastest SD card that you have on the market. You're getting such an incredible value. Plus, there are so many other manufacturers that are producing CF Express right now. So getting into the Z system is really a viable alternative for these professional photographers that need fast speed, that need these the best cards out there, and it's really easy to acquire, and dollar for dollar, the best value.
Wow, okay. So if I wanted to buy the new Z Mount 7200, can I use teleconverters on it, or is that not available
at
the time?
Look at that. I just happen to have one on me right now. Yes, so the teleconverters that are compatible with the 70-200 for the Z series, which is our S line lens, has compatibility with the native teleconverters. So we did announce teleconverters for this earlier this year, the 1.4 as well as the 2x. So look for that. If you're using the F mount lens on an FTZ adapter, you would use the F mount teleconverters. So, but we do have teleconverters for this that would bring it all the way up to 400 millimeters if you're using the 2x. So we have you covered. Everything from 14 millimeter to 400 millimeter right now. We have a range of 16 lenses, 2 teleconverters, 8 more lenses to come next year. And we've also announced another 3 for 2022. So this lineup is rapidly expanding. Remember when we announced this, we only had 2 cameras and 3 lenses. This was just 2 years ago. And now we have a full system complete with the 2.8 Trinity. Like you mentioned, the 70-200, but we also now have the 14-24 that we announced last month, as well as this 24-70, all in the 2.8 range. So professional photographers that are looking to get into the system, that wanted to get native glass on their native Z mount, they have it. They have dual card slots. They have the vertical battery grip, which is great when you're shooting telephoto because it balances the lens much better. It's all here, and it's a great time for the Z series.
I mean, is there anything that I missed on here question-wise you want to talk about that I didn't bring up?
I'll just mention for video, we are implementing 4K 60. So the 4K 60 is something that's going to be out of the box for the Z7 when it comes in December. And that'll be at a marginal crop. It'll be 93% of the full frame. The next thing is for the Z6II, that'll be addressed in a firmware update coming in about, I think, February of next year. And that will allow us to get 4K 60 in the Z6II at a DX crop. Okay, so these features are new. What other new features for video is videographers oftentimes that like to pull focus might have been using cine lenses in the past, and their muscle memory can't get used to turning the manual focus ring in the direction that Nikon lenses traditionally do. We have a menu feature in the camera now that allows you to reverse the direction of the manual focus ring so you can get over your muscle memory. So we've really been listening to the pro video community, and we want to make the transition over to some of our lenses that much more smooth, because the Z lenses are really fantastic for video. Minimal focus breathing, sharp quality edge to edge, sharp quality shot wide open at wide open apertures. They're quiet, they're silent, they're accurate, and they take full advantage of the Z mount. So I really wish people would really investigate the platform, because it's not only great for stills, but it's also great for video because of the characteristics of the optics that we have in our Z-line lenses. Other things that I guess while I have the platform here that I'll mention is that you guys have a test drive program right now for the Z5. So if people are looking to get into the platform, I would encourage them to check that out, because you can take the rate that you would pay for a rental, you know, and possibly apply it to the Z5 if you were to get it. A lot of the features that are available in a Z6 even are in the Z5. So if you want to kind of feel out whether it works with your existing F-mount lenses with an FTZ, take it out, and I'm confident people will love it. And one thing that I will mention is that we have launched a new adapter. This is called the WR-R11B adapter. It goes into the accessory terminal of both the Z6II and the Z7II, as well as the original Z6 and Z7. And the purpose of this trigger here is a couple of things. Number one, it can trigger your SP5000 flash via radio. And we've had optical triggers before for many, many years, but radio gives you additional distance. It gives you reliability. It allows you to penetrate through barriers and control multiple groups. Cool thing is, it's so elegant because it doesn't need a battery. It's get powered through the camera. You can adjust your flash through the interface of the camera. Plus, if you're doing video, it actually acts as a little light here, an indicator. Basically, I think the colloquial term is tally light. So you can know when you're recording. The other things it can do is it can remote control other cameras that have this transceiver. So if you have multiple cameras, if you're shooting and you want to have a quote unquote second shooter, put it on a tripod, you can remote control other Nikon cameras with this adapter. We also have a 10-pin version for this. So if you have a D850 or a D5 or something like that, it's the WRR11A adapter. So look for that. It's a cool little accessory that allow you to radio control other things.
Yeah, that's a fantastic accessory. Wow. All right. And I think, honestly, that will just about do it for today. Mark, thank you so much for joining us once again and giving us the rundown on these fantastic cameras. And I really hope we can do it again sometime.
Anytime, Josh. My pleasure.
Thank you all for tuning into this Nikon Q&A session. If you have any other questions about the brand new Nikon Z6 or Z7 II, feel free to give us a call, shoot us an email, or stop into one of our 8 stores located around New England.